Everything is alright. All we need is some direction. Every time the wind blows, everything you don't know turns into a revelation. And it all ends up inside your head. Time is wasted.
You are not going to believe what is about to happen. This is going to be out of control. Hell, hell, everybody. Welcome to the Colonial Smell the Ball. I forget what the hell it is. The Smell the Colonial Ballboys Christmas Special. This is Dr. J. It has been an absolute zoo. I feel like a guy trying to tame the tiger holding a chair and a whip. And I promise you, whoever raps first will get muted. That's you, Mark and Bob. I'm just telling you right now. Anyway, let's go through the roll call of what's supposed to take place over the next God knows how long till Spreaker cuts us off. First thing, Ewan from the Colonial Podcast. Say hello, everybody. Hell, hell, brother.
Hell, hell, mate. Hell, hell.
Hell, hell. And this is, we're spanning all types of time zones and everything else. What time is it in New Zealand?
Well, I'm actually in the future. I'm a day ahead of you all. It's the 23rd of December, 10 a.m. in the morning.
10 a.m. And you've been on the whiskey since?
6 a.m.
You can take the man out of Glasgow.
Because I'm not.
But you can't take the Glasgow out of the man.
Podcast sober when Bob and Mark will be half cut, and because they'll just rip the shit out of me for the next 2 hours, which they'll probably do anyway. So I thought I'd give myself a fighting chance. But being from the West End, my patter's slightly weaker than theirs, so I need to, you know, just.
That is weak. And for all the way from Belfast. The Belfast boy, Brian, say hello, everybody.
Hail, hail, lads. How's it going? It is 9:05 p.m. here on the 22nd of December, and that's freezing here in Belfast. So, all good. How are you doing, Dr. J?
I'm wonderful. This is actually interesting, because, by the way, this is the first time we've all been together and put it all together. Hopefully, we can get some people to listen to our stupid shit for the week, for the day before. We pick up a game on Saturday, but Brian, tell me this: what are some of the things you'd like to talk about today?
It burns when I pee sometimes.
You got the wrong doctor. I'm just telling you. Just saying. I can give you a referral.
I want to talk transfers.
Transfers.
I want to talk transfers. And I want to talk hung bashing in general.
You want to just? I tell you what. I know what I'd love to hear you do from a Northern Ireland accent. I'd love to hear the Garner song if you don't mind singing that for me later, and to see what it'd be like when the loyalists sing.
You want me to talk about the supporters?
So see,
listen, Dr. J's going to lose it, man. He will be off.
Sorry. I was just relieving myself. And from the south side of Glasgow, we have Ball Mark.
Hey!
Hello, hello.
All right, lads. That is That is HailHail Media's champions, by the way.
Oh. Congratulations, boys. Congratulations.
I would also like to hear about this burning when you pee thing. Is there a remedy to this?
Yeah, you just cut it off. It stops burning.
No, you can't, come on, you can't cut it off.
It just happens when you hit 40, it starts to. It just gets worse every year, really. So.
It's hard to cut it off when it barely exists, right? Isn't that the problem?
It was like the Vedan still game, but you know, you get that, you just can't stop the flow sometimes and just burns.
Actually, in still game, it's not stopping the flow, it's actually getting the flow to start. So if you're an actor in still game and you're, 49, 50 years old, you understand exactly what I'm talking about.
This would be in a chat with Mark, if you're in a chat with these old men, talking
about
how bad it is.
This is where we kick off a podcast.
Yeah, this is where we start. By the way, we're live. We're live. So enough of the penis stuff and the prostate issues. Let's get into this. So what we decided to do was actually get everyone together and talk about some stuff. So basically see if we can't pull everyone to listen together. I know the first thing, obviously, I wanted to hear about. And I don't know if everyone listens to all the different things. There's a couple things I'd like to know. And the first thing I would love to know is, from Ballmark, why did you go after the homeboys? That's the question I have for you guys.
You got to go for the top, didn't you?
Well, no, they went for us. We just dealt with a threat.
Self-defense, that's what it was.
We're going to have to get Harper. We're going to have to get Harper in here in a minute. But go ahead. I want to hear the rest of this.
Old Choke McKenna bottled it at my rap. R.I.P. Choke. Who's next? McKenna. They spelled, Dr. J can't understand the word we're saying, so we brought in the Colonial to...
you can't understand me now, because I'm from the West End, apparently, so... You can't.
Everybody's favourite. Oh, the Colonial.
How's that going to work? Dr. J can understand me. That's fine. We'll do the podcast and you guys can talk on the sides. We'll be sweet.
You know, there you go. Thanks, Ewan.
Well, back to why we went for Homeboys. Homeboys think they're the top.
They went for us.
Top of HailHail Media. We had a few bit of banter with them. They thought they could take us on and it didn't work.
They went for us, honestly. They went for us.
But why? I mean, Joe, I know Joe loves a little rap music, but come on.
I think that Harper's musical goings on should be a weekly occurrence in the Homeboy Show. Like, name that tune or some sort of thing, and using different household items like pots and pans and stuff like that.
Yeah. Why? That boy's got a gift from God for music, I tell you.
And what gift is that? You want to go ahead and tell us what gift that is?
It made me laugh. I was crying with tears listening to him try to play those songs on that whistle. Oh my God.
The only way we could pick out what song it was when they gave us a fucking clue.
Let's Google.
Like, you mean clue, like, here's the title of the song, now guess it?
I see.
So,
it was one of the clues.
So I'll give you this. So we can get this out of the way. What was your rap?
You want to hear my rap?
All right, let's so because if not, you're gonna try and sneak it in anyway. So might as well go ahead and try it.
You want me to do it? I'll do it.
I'll let him do it,
otherwise he'll have a fit.
Right, Mark, give me a beatbox this time. That's your coughing, mate. Come on, a beatbox.
Ready? 1, 2, 3.
Oh, yeah. Look, I'm sure Joe's rap will be brutal, but he's taking shots in the dark. I kind of need to be nice, because I actually show face in Celtic Park. Yeah, there you go. It'll be a nice treat. It'll give me a lot of joy. Is that what you've been doing for weeks? Because you've certainly not been hosting any episodes of Homeboys.
No,
You're the host. You call yourself a Jola Coaster. Won't be long till you're asking for a Ballboys poster. You was sitting there thinking he's Parappa the Rapper. Paul Arkin's sitting there blinding us with his balding apper. Paul, McDonald's in the local chippy. After this, we'll see where your listeners come get their chips from. In case anybody does it, that he slagged us on Twitter. Lemons out the roof, mate. Ballboys are here. Don't be so bitter. Homeboys in the meter is well intact. This counts as one of our shows, in fact. Odds were stacked against us right from the get-go. Our crooked referee's currently sharing a room with Joe. Joe, I'm not saying their wife should worry, but maybe it's not the Ballboys who are HailHailMedia's Bert and Ernie. Same as taking me dances. I'm going to pass it to Joe, who's been rapping all his life. I've been doing it for 2 minutes. Plus, Ballboys for life!
Tremendous. Tremendous.
Unbelievable.
Wow. Wow.
That is nothing to homeboy.
Wow.
You're welcome, lads. You're welcome. That's me. I'm out, mate. It was nice. It was nice being on the show.
Just drop the mic, mate. Drop the mic.
Is that a drop the mic? Yeah.
Wow, that was.
Fuck out.
Do you guys offer 30 seconds of your life back after that? Wow.
Hey, hey boys, how you doing?
Oh, guess who's here?
That's Johnny.
Johnny. Oh, look at this.
African correspondents in the fucking building.
So you're where now?
Best sound of the night.
Have you been attacked by any monkeys so far?
Nah, no yet. I had a bit of a close call today, but everyone's going crazy, man. I've fucking kissed far worse than South America, like, it's nothing.
Johnny, what time is it where you are?
Quarter past 11.
Yeah, so it's not, okay, got it. And from the back of which truck picking up satellite Wi-Fi are you driving right now?
So I'm on the lookout for Dave King. I've built like an underground lair near his big fucking mansion, and I'm just waiting for him to come out, and I'm going to get some information out of him or do something to infiltrate his dirty fucking tax dodging South African bastard doings.
No. Leave him alone. I don't want him to leave Rangers at all, or Sevco, or whatever the hell they're called this week. Let him stay there. That's the best, don't you think? Wouldn't that be the best?
Absolutely. If they, I mean, what is actually? I'm not if you boys have covered it, but what is going on with all these fucking songs, man? Like all these, they're battling against some girl band to reach Xmas number one.
Well, that was me rapping against Joe.
What were you, was that you on Sky TV, like, pumping your hands up in there, like?
When you chase a girl. When I beat the choker coaster in that rap, that's my claim to fame, man.
See, if you went on Twitter and looked at that, they were actually getting into arguments with one of the girls from the band. There was like to and fro between them and the Huns. So the girls in the band were basically saying, why are you on our Twitter page?
I don't understand any of that. Like, why? I mean, it's nuts. They get so tied up in the stupid shit. It's crazy. It really, really is. But Johnny, let me ask you this. What are your travel plans in the next couple months? Where are you headed from and to? Where are you going?
So I'm staying here in South Africa for 2 months, and then on the 28th of February I'm going stateside. My visa, I'd like to just reiterate, my visa has been approved, all over the table. Legal visa to work in the United States.
Oh,
I'm going to go to New York and working at.
You talk about it. You tell the fucking, what is it? The DSS immigration department to look you up.
This is where to come get me.
Every time, he's like, by the way, just in case anyone's listening, just don't be quiet.
So you're going to be in New York. You're going to be in New York by St. Patrick's Day, right?
Yeah, I'll be there for the. Are you still planning on doing a party like a Jersey, New York, and Philly? Or
something? Oh yeah, Chris will be Chris, and those guys will be hosting the rest of the team from the Celtic Dream Show. As far as a full blown week of alcohol induced stupid behavior. So yes, that'll be that week.
You can count me in for that 100%. I'll be there.
I thought you said you were going to work. You're going to get there and go straight on it then.
Yeah, well, one of my pals he's got me a job in a Scottish pub. So I'm sure I'll be able to work something out. Like, I'll be there like 100%.
There you go.
I can't even be in New York and if all yous are going out, on out like fucking on the party, and I'm just going to be.
I know. I mean, I wasn't going to go, but I mean, if you're going to fly all the way from South Africa to go to New York, I have to go.
Yeah, of course. So. I get everyone fucking about it. Paul's coming down from Montreal as well, you know.
I don't know if Paul make it. We'll
this
see.
Is travelplans.com.
I know. It's talking about Celtic. Well, this is a St. Patrick's Day travel event. So we'll get that worked on.
How's it going? What you up to, my man?
Hello, can you hear me?
Aye, what you up to, Bill Fast Boy?
I'm just sitting here. I was trying to go to the toilet again there. It's still burning.
Oh, fucking hell.
Oh, man.
No, I thought all the HailHailMedia travel plans had to be done through Jason Higgins.
He's retired.
That shop's shut now, isn't it?
He's semi-retired now. He just comes out for the odd rant. But he has the master, so...
Oh, no, he is. We can't be bad about Jason. Jason's a big Ballboys fan.
Big Ballboys fan.
Any opportunity to big your podcast up, keep going.
Right. I thought if us big enough your podcast.
Maybe care what you
don't. So let's see. So Brian, let me ask you a question. Besides the burning thing, let me ask you this. What have you been over in any games this year?
This year, no, I haven't. The last game I was at was a Ronnie Dale game. Sorry, I had to swear on the podcast. I said the RD. It was a Killy game. I believe it was just before you were over for the Astra game.
Oh, yeah. Oh, God, it's a while ago, yeah.
That was October there, a year ago. So hope to get over this year. I haven't got a season ticket this year because it's really, really, really hard to get at the moment, as I'm sure everyone knows, but family commitments and stuff makes it very hard for me to get over to every single game. So I'm an armchair fan at the moment. I'm not ashamed to say so.
Nah, you're a fan.
No shame in that.
Maybe. No shame in that. We all can't get there. Trust me. So in Belfast, is it the same level of hype as it is everywhere else as far as among Celtic fans?
Yeah, it's fever pitch. I mean, I think I said I was talking to Paul Larkin a while ago about this, and we're saying that this type of stuff needs to be bottled and sold, because what we're experiencing now is just wow, you know. When the media can try and under hype it, we're in a slump because we're only winning 1-0 and 2-0, and it's you know that it's all just a spin to try and make us feel that it isn't good enough. It's certainly not the standards that we've now set ourselves with Brendan coming in, but he's given youth a chance there as well. So the academy's bearing fruit. We're unbeaten, and I'm high on Celtic at the moment, and I'm not pure buzzing about it.
It's crazy. It's the same thing here. I'm sure in New Zealand, you get people noticing it more, because I mean it's easy to ask Bob Mark and go, hey, listen, what do you think about what's going on? And it's around them all the time. But for us, I mean, are you getting people that are saying, hey, I can't, I saw Celtic the other day? Are you getting that too in New Zealand?
I know that, I know that the NZCSC is getting more number. We've got the Sevco game at New Year. It's been shown in a pub in town. I'm not allowed to actually say the name of the pub yet because it's not actually confirmed. But the numbers for watching the games are up. And I mean, to be honest, most New Zealanders follow the EPL. They're not really aware of Scottish football in New Zealand, but it's a big game here. But Yeah, I think it's like anything else. I mean, it's like, you know, when Celtic are doing good, and especially when Celtic are playing in Europe, people notice them. It's the strip is iconic. No one else has a strip like us. The green and white hoops is very noticeable. So yep. I've had a few Kiwis talk about. I had three people stop me in the street after the Man City game when I was wearing my Celtic top out, and they were talking about it and stuff. So as our profile, Brendan Rodgers has raised the club's profile, like, you know, and that is only going to continue as far as I can see.
Speaking of raising profile, you won't believe who joined us. Pauly D, are you there? St. Pauly D.
Busy fuck, man. Oh, lazy fucking
bastard. Is he there? Bastard. I thought he was working. Now he shows up. Did you unmute yourself, Paul? Speaking of people showing up.
How many people is actually on this now?
We got 7 or 8. But I know, Paul, where are you? Unless he's... You gotta unmute yourself. Gotta hit the little button at the top that says little microphone. Turns you on. Oh, well. We tried to bring Paul in, and he doesn't want to listen. We tried. Anyway, so over here, it's funny, because my son, when he trains, everywhere he trains, he always has a Celtic top on. And it's the point now where it's getting noticed a lot more. It's getting noticed a lot more. It's actually pretty cool. Paul, you there?
I'm here. There
you
go.
Can
you hear me?
Speaking of, now we've covered how many continents with Montreal in the house?
Yeah, we can hear you, mate.
What's going on, guys? Merry Christmas.
How you doing, man?
How you doing?
Merry Christmas, mate.
So, Paul, tell us. Listen, I want to ask you real quick before you get into this. Are you seeing people showing up at the Montreal CSC?
No.
Wasn't Toronto pretty big, too?
Same 12 people, mate. Nah, it's just, I don't know, Montreal is obviously a tough sports market as it is. So if they watch football, they watch the English Premier League. So it's me and about 12 other guys who just go to Montreal. So Johnny's on the line.
I am here, man.
All right. Here, man, I finished faking that American visa for me. Do you want me just to send that across to you? Like, looks pretty legit.
Well, I have no idea. I have no idea what you're talking about. Any DSS, American, RS are listening to this. This is nothing to do with me. I actually have got my illegal fucking question.
Even got a wee hologram and shit.
I told you last week, just show them that Mexican tattoo you've got on your leg or whatever that is, the patient states of transvestites. And you're soft.
Here, I was hearing rap battles earlier on. Are you guys fucking beefing? I love that shit. Who can I beef? What other podcast can I just rip the piss out of?
Darren Ball, he wants beef. He's looking for all comers.
So I was doing a piss there. I'm just back. What happened?
Was it burning?
I'll beef. I'll beef 90 minutes in it.
You want to hit that one? They're next.
90 minutes. I don't know if they would rap, actually. They don't strike me as the kind of rap type.
Strike me as a bunch of West End boys like yourself.
You're too hip. Well, but, you know, it's beneath me to rap being from the West End.
I can barely hear that any. I'm at work now. I just went to the phone and say, hail, hail to the ladies. Cool, Johnny, when you're in New York, man, batter up to Montreal and we'll have a good time up here as well. Don't know if I'll be crossing
the border
anytime soon. But I get yourself up. Try and make sure Dr. J doesn't talk too much pish on the show and I'll catch you all later.
Too late.
Take it easy, boys. Right?
Too late.
Hail, mate. See you.
Later, Paul. Yeah, he's a little too late for me not to talk shit, but. As the Smell the Glove podcast has already claimed, we are the least prepared of anyone to be on HailHailMedia. So that's just how it is.
We're a well prepared podcast at the Ballboys, so I agree.
Yes. So we got the question. The question that we got into the chat room was, "What's tonight's agenda?" The agenda was for each one of us to come up with a bit from each one of our shows and then go ahead and use it. And then go from there.
Stuff. I've got stuff.
So we've got stuff. So who's got stuff?
I've got stuff.
The guy who ever said that clearly missed my rap. That was my agenda. That was I'm done.
as per usual, they'll just rip the arse out of it until it's fucking in the arse.
Exactly. So you and you got...
The transfers.
You and you got... You want to go first? You and you want to go first?
Don't let the Colonial speak, man. We're here all night. Never heard this.
We just fucking recycle the same jokes week after week.
Could you a rap twice, man, and everybody hates you? Yeah,
no, actually, that rap, I mean, that was quite emotional.
I was asked. Rap.
Hey, go Colonial, what you got?
Here's your agenda, Colonial.
Right, okay, so I was going to talk about... Well, I was going to ask you a bunch of questions, but I was thinking we should talk about... Wait for it.
We'll spit it out.
Is it right? So, right, these are the notes I made last night before I came on, and the first note is Bobby Madden is a baldy mason.
Bobby Madden.
Bobby Madden.
Is it? Oh, yeah.
Bobby
but
Madden.
If you look at that last party, the last game we played, he wasn't too bad, but I think just about every referee we've had since the season began has made it as difficult as possible for us to do. Like, you can, it's like when we score a goal, they're like, oh, you fucking bastards, I can't fucking... It's just fucking... It's pathetic.
Did you watch the game? Was it Dundee? And had the wee midget ref that I've never heard of before?
Aye, the wee Frodo-looking guy.
The wee tiny guy. He gave 3 minutes added time, right? And he was... the ball went out the box, and it was 2-1. And Dundee went to swing it in, but we won the ball. He wasn't going to blow the whistle until we won the ball, so he was going to let them swing it right back in.
He's an arm, mate.
I have no idea who that was. Do you know who that was? The wee tiny guy?
Let's just call him Frodo.
They just Frodo the out. There's a conveyor
Frodo,
belt.
Frodo the mini mason.
Frodo the mini mason.
Dr. Evil's wee sidekick.
I think it looked like the girl out of the Crankies.
Now, I was listening to that BBC Sports Sound podcast as well, when the first thing that Richard Gordon comes out with, like, it was basically, they do the intro to the podcast and then they're like, and the score was this, 1-0 at Celtic. And the very first words out of his mouth, well, Celtic are a pale shadow of the side they once were. And for the next 20 minutes, that whole podcast was just talking about how pish we were and how shite we were. And I was thinking, am I living an alternate reality from these guys? Because we're fucking about to be 17, maybe even 20 points clear of everybody else.
It was probably Stilly Bridge Celtic they're talking about.
Fucking Richard Gordon is such a bitter sheep. He's a bitter wee sheep, that Richard Gordon is. He doesn't even try and hide it. And then they get Barry Ferguson on. He's like, aye, you're right, Richard. I'm not that good, are they? And it's like, for smoke's sake, man. That podcast is turning into Clyde. Slime.
I just don't listen to any of them, to be honest with you. I only listen to our stuff. Because you'd end up probably wanting to self-harm if you're fucking listening to the shit that they're churning out. So at least... The worst you can hear on some of our podcasts is someone talks about Stokesy.
What'd you say?
Or
did you say something?
Or Ronnie Dyla.
What did Brian? What'd you say?
Can't talk about Stokes on this podcast.
Sorry. I was about to fall asleep and someone mentioned Stokesy. Not that Stokes gets mentioned in all of any of the podcasts that I'm ever on. But go ahead. I'm sorry.
What's that?
Said not that Stokes ever gets mentioned on any of the podcasts that we're on. I'm just you know, you got my attention.
Doctor Jay,
do you want me to host?
No. No. Fucking, we've been rapping and everything.
So go ahead, Ewan. What else do you have for us, Ewan? Go ahead. What else? Besides Bobby
right,
Madden.
So I was going to ask you, right, so apart from Bobby Madden, I was looking at the stat, basically, like when teams come to Celtic Park, they do exactly the same thing, right? It's like this, it's almost as if, they can't, like, if you look at Partick, they actually tried to play, now all the stats from the last three games are the same. We had 60% possession, about the same fouls and tackles, but that last game, they actually had more shots on target than anybody else. It's just like, why not come to Parkhead and just try and play football? I get it. I get the whole fuck. Well, you're better losing by one goal than losing by five. But I really, like, does it make a difference? You're not getting 3 points, and you go out looking like a bunch of fannies by not trying to play football. You're just putting everybody in front of the box. And because you look at Dembele, right? Like, he plays well right up until he takes his shot. Now, the box is packed out, so he's trying to squeeze a shot in, but every time Dembele takes a shot, it's quite weak. Like, he's not getting a lot of power behind the ball, and I'm not saying that's because they're packing defences out, but just, I don't know, I wish they would come to Parkhead and just play out a bit, you know, instead of just camping in.
I thought Thistle actually played decent against
this
man. They
aye.
Did come out and attack
us. The priority
team.
Hey, what I seen for the Partick game, look, Partick actually came out and attacked us. They had a mere possession of the ball than anybody at Parkhead, even Sevco. But they had mere chances. I think it all boils down to that when we get the ball, they all sit back and just they.
There's nothing they can do, is there, when we just let pile the pressure on? Nah. But I thought that they did play all right. The other teams, I thought they'd probably been the most adventurous team at Parkhead.
I actually seen a few Dundee fans actually saying that they would rather...
Colonial, is that not your local team as well?
a few Dundee fans they'd rather take a beating off a Celtic and attack them and sit back and take like an onslaught of 70% possession and 15-20 goals on target. So let's see, like teams like Partick coming out and actually like in a Glasgow derby attacking us, I welcome it. And to be honest, it was actually quite a good game, even though the scoreline wasn't what all Celtic fans wanted. But like, I'll take games like that, you know what I mean? Week in, week out.
This isn't the audible if they offer insight analysis like this. If you're ever going to listen to the show on HailHailMedia, listen to us. Woo!
Well, I mean, if you compare it to last year, this same time last year, struggling to get, and the big difference is struggling to get 1-0s out of people. You know, I'm willing to bet you look at last year's results or the way teams played last year. No one sat in against us last year. They attacked Ronnie's team last year. Big difference between last year and this year, and now sitting in after a couple teams trying to go out against us, now sitting in, there's a big difference between how much people were afraid of what Ronnie's team would do to them versus what Brendan's team would do to us. That's what I've seen last year. Big difference.
As well, you can tell that Brendan's not feared to change anything. You know, when something's not working, he's no fear to make subs, whereas. Whereas last year, it's like Dyla's team was so fucking predictable, and so were his tactics. Like within, you know, 8 games of the season, every team knew what to do against us, and they knew that we didn't have a plan B. Whereas this year, like I say, like Brendan's no fear to make a change, and when he does make changes, they pretty much all of them, or at least 90% of them, have got a positive impact on the game.
Oh, totally, big difference. And by the way, just so we could get another continent involved, I believe Pat, are you there? Pat in Melbourne, where are you at?
From
half the world away.
What half the world away?
I am trying. I'm trying my best. You press that wee mute button and it doesn't come on. So just sort of introduce. This is Pat Flores from the Half the World Away Dirk Borrichter Celtic podcast.
Hello, Pat.
You the
hey, boys.
Why you throwing
that? Pat. G apostrophe D, as you would say.
I'm on my holidays already. I thought, how can I keep myself asleep lying in bed? And I thought, I'll go and see if there's any podcasts on. And yeah, you guys have put me to sleep, so I thought I'd jump in for a minute or two and just say hello. So.
The insomniac's dream.
You don't really do the whole podcast thing now, eh? It's kind of.
We're out partying all the time, out partying. It's just it's tough, But you guys are really posh. You just go to a meeting. Jesus Christ, we use bloody Skype.
Dr. J's got the pro set up, man. Apparently, he has 5,000 people on at the same time.
It sounds like it.
Yeah, we are testing the 5,000 people at the same time thing. Yeah.
See this custom Cairo Solutions. Is that your company's elders, Jay? You try to fucking do some marketing while we're on this thing.
Yeah, kind of, sort of. But yeah.
Fucking.
As bad as the Ballboys, just any chance.
Somebody Google custom Cairo solution. Google it and see what it is.
Doesn't yeah, let, sound good. Let's just leave that alone for now. I knew I should have changed the name on it. Let's now start getting hacks from all over the world. This is crazy. But anyway, hey, Pat, by the way.
That are in need of any chiotherapy on the go.
Let's not do that. Solution. No, let's not do that. Pat, by the way, this is MB Badeep saying hello. So when you get the MB Badeep and you start saying, oh, that's because I usually catch your show when I'm on a 6 a.m. flight and you guys are in the middle of your day.
That fingerprint looks a bit ominous. That fingerprint. Yeah, it looks ominous.
You're just suspicious. Suspicious mind.
Leave my website alone.
Recognize it, that's all. I recognize the fingerprint.
Recognize it. CSI Castle Milk.
He burgled my house. That fingerprint burgled my house.
Oh my god, that's too much.
It's not common for the Ballboys to see them because theirs have been bleached and acided off on account of all the stuff they've been up to back in Glasgow.
We need to speak to Pat. Pat, what's been happening, mate?
A bit of this and that, a few medical issues and stuff like with a couple of the guys, myself included. But it's just hard to get people.
Is that wear and tear?
Something like that, yeah. I wouldn't say about Kev's little rash, but that's another story. But
that's all right, because the Belfast boy burns when he goes to pee, now he's saying so.
I think we've taken the whole doctor thing to a new level. This is some sort of like fucking, I don't know, like medical phoning thing here with all sorts of ailments needed.
Should I start my list then? Just go through them all, I'm getting on a bit. We kept getting wound up about on Twitter, but we are getting on a bit. But we're just finding it hard to get. You know, we'll get four of us nolly come on, and with our slot, I guess we put it that way, is a kind of Friday night. And surprisingly, people actually have things to do on Friday nights. So it's getting a bit tough to get people together. But we're planning a wee, if we can get it organised, a wee extravaganza before the end of the year. But we'll see how we go.
Don't leave us. Don't leave us, boys. We need you.
It'll
be up to me to represent Australia, and you don't want that. That's you don't want that.
No, we definitely don't.
Podcast challenges you the same way we challenged the homeboys.
Oh.
And we won, by the way.
That was a fix. Come on, guys, really.
We've got a healthy relationship. We support each other full of positivity.
Yes. And you owe me 20 quid for that Bruce Willis thing, remember? I told you to pick the first one.
Well, to be fair, Belfast boy, I didn't believe that you ever met Bruce Willis. So
I did.
I'll be back in a minute. I'll be back to the
floor. Stood on him.
He fell over me. But the yippee-ki-yay motherfucker thing didn't happen.
Paul wasn't he too happy with you? Yeah, you're a wee lie there.
No, he says it's an absolute disgrace.
Champion.
I think what was quite amusing was the fact that it started off as a bit of fun, but you could hear it getting more competitive the closer it got to the end. You know, and you could just hear it, and it was like, you know, the real get it right up these bits.
Pat, are you and the Ballboys going to go ahead and start this half a world away versus Ballboys beef? So I want to hear your rap too. That'd be good.
Who's that? The half a world away? But wait there, did you notice that it only got serious with the homeboys when they went behind?
Aye.
Because they didn't believe that the Ballboys would mop the floor with them. Which we did. Quite convincingly, man. Mopped a shitty floor with them.
I'm not taking part in this because I've got friends on either side. I'm keeping well out of it.
World away on, man. Bring them on.
We'll take you on in a new year beef.
Who's next?
The
homeboys have a rematch clause.
A rematch.
Jason.
Hey, I'll tell you something. I'll tell you something. This is a long, long, long time ago, but the precursor to the whole half a world away thing was a homeboys down under. That I'd kind of hassled Dave Harper about to do for a long, long time, and eventually he kind of agreed to it. And so He wasn't working at the time, and he basically, it was him and I, and we'd try and get some folk from Australia on, and he was half cut half the time. But anyway, so we had a competition one night, and I was on this Homeboys Down Under, and I won the competition, and he promised me, and I say promised, he promised to send me some DVD of all the Celtic goals from 1902 to 19 whatever, and I still haven't received it. Yeah, that's, and I still haven't received it. No,
even telling you, they're bastards.
Yeah, so David Harper, if you're listening to this, David Harper, I want my DVD, you promise, and I'll win the competition fair and square. I know it was about 3 years ago, but I'm still waiting.
I seen him selling a DVD on eBay to pay for penny whistle lessons.
I bet he fucking loses them, that's for sure.
Ballboy,
I've got to say
that. As well.
Do you actually want the trophy that was promised us?
We want a trophy.
The HailHailMedia Champions Belt.
We are pretty much the main event of HailHailMedia these days. Sorry, lads, we're just here to promote.
You got a bit of a confidence issue. I think you need to just believe in yourselves a bit more.
No good belief.
Colonial is like the Ballboys Drunk Uncle podcast. Listen to it every Monday. He's on right after us. After we leave, still talking shite.
That's it.
Listen to these guys. It's like the Gallagher brothers of the HailHailMedia, isn't it?
The Gallagher.
It was the Chuggle brothers.
Gallagher brothers.
We certainly only the belt and aren't they?
They've never left. They don't leave. You know they don't leave Castle Milk. They just go from there to the pub to the game and then back again. That's it. I don't even think they know where the West End is.
Yeah. Don't. Oh, right. Oh, I'm sorry for going to games, lads. But did you know hear my rap?
Haters gonna hate that.
Should we talk some more about Celtic, or we'll just sit and give each other abuse for the
So what is it? What does everyone think about Commons moving on? And obviously Lisa Haig's heartfelt letter on Twitter. What's people's thoughts on that?
I need to get myself a hip start. Start supporting them.
I liked it yesterday when Dr. J asked Rev, he said, what would you say to Chris Commons? What would your partner was? And Rev said, thanks for the last 2 years.
Once again, proving we are the most underprepared show on Hail Hail Media.
About 2 years. Oh, God. Rev's great, man. I love that, man.
Wait there. Can Chris Commons rap?
He can wrap up fish suppers, no problem, by the looks of it.
Aye, by the looks of it, no, he can unwrap them, no bother.
He's right here again.
That's it. I know his wife to be, I think it is, Lisa. She done a lot of amazing charity work for the club. She was probably more involved in the club than Chris has been in the last 18 months or so. So people like that are. It's good to see people like her who knew absolutely nothing about Celtic come in and completely embrace it for what it is and buy into it. And although she tried to slander the name of Buckfast, but I'm sure we can forgive her for that.
Devil's juice,
dragon juice.
There you go. Dragon juice. So hey, listen. Let me add something to what Brian said. Do you think? Because I know we had this conversation tonight. Do you think the Molda incident left a bad taste in your mouth over Chris? Now that he's gone, does it ruin anything for you guys?
No, definitely not. It shows passion more than anything, and I think that he got the fans and he got the club, and I don't think Dale did. I'm not sure what anybody else thinks.
I agree. I think Chris Commons was. When I remember when it happened, and when you've got a guy who scored 30 goals, you know, and then next season he's standing there, making an example of himself, shouting at the manager and pointing at the fans. Something's wrong at the club. You know, any which way you look at it, that shouldn't happen. Something like that has never happened. Does anyone remember a player doing that? So there was obviously something wrong, and it was Ronnie Dyler that was wrong.
I'm kind of in the same boat. I reckon it was just that era of the club. I think there was obviously things happening in the background that we weren't privy to, but you know, there were rumours. But I think it was just him venting, I guess. But I saw something recently that someone did, I can't even think of the game I watched, might even be one of, towards the end of a Sevco game or something, someone did the same thing, get dragged off as a sub and they started having a crack. Actually, because I thought back to the Chris Commons one, I don't think it taints it in any way. I think he was a good servant. He came in, you know, at right time for us in the first game against Aberdeen. He scored, was it a lob or something? I can't quite remember the goal. I know he scored in the first game.
Yeah,
he came on as a sub. And
at Hampton, his first game.
Think of games against the former Huns and stuff like that. He was a pretty good servant. And people, anyway, says he wasn't. Are kidding themselves. He was a great player for us at the right time, and really? I guess for him the unfortunate thing is that Brendan Rodgers came in and it just his style of play just doesn't fit. There's nothing more than that. He's still a good player, probably still got the skills, but I think his time's kind of coming and gone for us, and best of luck to him at Hibs.
Look, Papa, yeah, I agree with you. I think he did put some good performances. He scored some amazing goals for Celtic.
His first goal was at Hampden, wasn't it, in the semi-final.
Yeah, but I just think that his time was done. Like, Rodgers was never going to play him. He was never in his frame of mind. Like, for what I can see from the outside, like, obviously we don't know what happens in the dressing, but for the outside you can see that he's not going to fit into the performance that Celtic put in. But I think, except for what he's done, thank him for what he's done, and it's just time to move on. It's this is a new era of Celtic, and a new era of players coming through, and it's about
last season, when he was kind of playing, you would have been like, nah, I don't know, 50-50. But this season, he's not getting a game even when he's fit, so does it really matter if he leaves?
Who does he replace to bring him into the Celtic side?
Look at Dr. J trying to figure out what we're actually saying.
See if you bring him into Celtic side, and who do you drop? Like, there's not a player in that team you would drop for Chris Commons at the moment. Performance is this. So it's time.
Well, he plays that the position behind the forwards, and there's a couple of guys doing that already. He doesn't have the energy of even someone like, you know, Armstrong or something like that, but doesn't have the skill of Rogic. I mean, I guess it does, but it's a different sort of skill. But I think you're right. His time's just kind of came and went. Bear in mind, he's 33 years old, and I'm not sure Rodgers would play him, you know, for the experience. But you've got guys in there who's, you know, be well ahead of him in the scheme of things. So, as I said, you know, he's had a reasonably good career for us. He became a Scotland international through us, and so, I mean, fair dues to the guy.
I think if anything, there, Pat, he would have been an impact sub, like a 60-minute man or something like that. But be under no illusions that these are business. This is strictly business by Brendan Rodgers. This isn't the heart ruling the head where you're Tony Stokes and you can't sell Stokesy and you can't sell Chico and you can't sell Commons. But these are football and business decisions, ballsy decisions that Dylan never had the balls to make. Lennon never really had the balls to make, and Rodgers. And whatever he decides, I completely buy into it, and I can't remember the last time I said that about a Celtic manager.
Yeah, well, look at Pat, this is how right you are. If you take the last game and you want to put Commons in there, you'd have to replace Henderson. At the end of the game, Henderson was closing people down in the 88th, 89th, 90th minute. Commons wasn't going to do that. He wasn't going to run around. He wasn't going to close that down. That's the reason why. And if you think about it, the way Brendan's talking about the problem with playing two strikers, the play kind of dissolves and doesn't happen the way he wants it to because he doesn't have that extra person to go ahead and do that in the middle of the park. And that's right there, that one decision to play in that manner really, really explains why, even healthy, Commons just isn't going to get a shot. He just never was.
What did everybody think of Calvin Miller's performance?
A good Castle Milk boy, Calvin Miller. So I was all for it. He looked a bit out of his depth, man, but he's from Castle Milk.
Well, that's all right. That's a handicap he can overcome, I reckon.
Yeah, we have to forgive people for some of their failings, you know. So
the last Castle Milk boy is James McCarthy, so if we sign him, then
he's coming home.
Get it up, yees lads. See you, milk.
Not from Castle Milk.
Fuck your rest, then, Colonial.
You made that up.
No, yes.
He's in that from Mount Florida.
Picked off him. He played the secondary school. He pegged me, man.
He pegged everything these two.
No, but to be fair, we let young boy that played the other night. He is actually a left winger. He wasn't a left back. He is a left winger.
No, he's more of a wing back. That's because he was. That's what I thought. I'll be honest. I didn't know anything about him. I'm not. But he looked like he was a left wing back.
Why you don't want to know anything about him?
Castle Milk. Anyway, is that near Edinburgh?
Aye.
Oh. Oh, but see, on that, Rodgers sees a lot in players and he wants to actually.
Good
Castle Milk players that want to actually influence how he actually plays. And he moved him to left back, and I thought he played amazing for Castle Milk boy.
No, we're only the second most famous guns for Castle Milk right now, then, eh?
Oh, God.
Sure, I'm from Castle Milk as well, you know. He's got quite a. Castle Milkian accent.
I think Job Steen was born in Castle Milk. In fact, most of the Lisbon Lions came from Castle Milk, did they not?
Right, was Nelson Mandela not fucking. Was Nelson Mandela's auntie not for Castle Milk?
No, he's
fucking Bruce Willis was from Castle Milk as well, for fuck's sake.
Ah! You're all gonna get this shit right in your face when you find out James McCarthy was from Castle Milk. I was in school with him, man. But 10 years below me, but was in the same school.
Well, that's a good segue. I had a piece here. I was going to ask everybody. Everybody's got. Just calm down.
It's McCarthy, it's from Castle Milk!
Can you have you got a dark room for him to lie in, and he can come back in a couple of minutes?
Just a bit of gaggle, but it's all
right. Right, I was going to ask everybody. Everybody's got an association with a club somehow. Somebody knows somebody. So, do any of you guys have an association with like a famous player or someone famous at Celtic? Somebody, either somebody you've met or somebody you know who knows someone or something like that. Do any of you have a connection to the club?
I can do one of those. It's a long, long time ago, though. Well, not that long, I suppose, but Brian McClair. He was best mates with my brother, played in the same school football team, and when he played with Motherwell, I used to kind of go out and socialise with my brother and stuff. And they signed for Celtic. I still remember coming to the house, to my mother's house, God bless her, and people saying, was that Brian McClair going into your house? And I still think fondly back in those times. Those were when I started going to games, Brian McClair and Mo Johnson and stuff like that, and Roy Aiken, whatever. So that's kind of my one link, I think, only back there. But
player is like my brother played in the same St Andrews football team as David Marshall. Anybody remember David Marshall?
Aye.
Barcelona.
Of course.
Exactly. My brother.
He's from Castlemouth, isn't he?
Oh no, he's not. He's not good enough to Castlemouth.
That was Arthur Burridge. He was from Castlemouth.
That's right.
I went to the same school as James McCarthy.
Well, here's a sweeping statement, right? I went to the same school, not the same. Same age, obviously, as, wait for it, Antoine Rogan.
Why is this week Belfast boy? I don't know if I'm willing to believe this.
No, Antoine Rogan, true story. True story, Antoine Rogan. Bruce Willis was a year above us, though.
Anybody else? Johnny, have you got a famous connection?
I've got Jim Craig. Jim Craig retired to Crete, a little village I'm from, and he went to Mass with my dad and my sister. But sorry to disappoint you, but he's a bit of a fucking arsehole, to be honest with you. Like,
is he? No.
He's just a bit full of himself. I mind that he brought the European Cup to Mass one day as well, and he was just a bit full of himself, and like he wasn't really much of a fan. He was like more of like a Celtic player, like speaking last night, we were picking about the recurrent team, and he was just like, rubbish, rubbish. We're not as good as my day, and yeah, just not as humble as you'd expect for a Lion, but, well,
do you remember when Ireland beat Georgia, and McGeady passed the ball to McCarthy? Goal made in Castlemilk, lads. Two Castlemilk boys.
So Darren, what's your... Bob, have you got a connection to the club?
Oh, call me Darren. Hi, I went to school with James McCarthy.
All right. I saw that coming.
Honestly...
Oh, he is from Castlemilk. That's a pure fact.
That is a fact. He did go to St. Margaret Mary's in Castlemilk. And Bob did go to St. Margaret Mary's in Castlemilk.
I was about 3 years ahead of him.
Aye.
And we never played together.
I thought it was 10 years, about fucking 10 seconds ago.
I was trying to kid them, I was old to impress you. I'm actually only...
Well, I'll give you mine. My missus, her best friend that she grew up with, her best friend that she grew up with is married to Jock Steen's grandson.
Oh,
hats off. What a great manager.
Did Colonial come up with this question?
Aye.
Right, aye. Okay, that's it. Aye, you win, Colonial.
I will give you that one, Colonial. That is hats off.
I won't big up myself.
You're waving your lolly about Lamb, I would
never do that after a famous victory. We'd be talking about it every 5 minutes.
I would never do that.
Right, over to you, Dr. J. That's enough out of us.
We've made a turn after this podcast. Celtic football players.
Do I know anybody?
Honest, I do.
Well, actually, Paul just tweeted and reminded me that Darlington Nagby is from Castlemilk. So, Darlington Nagby, the American that they want to sign, he's from Castlemilk, is what Paul just told me.
Castlemilk.
He's not Celtic. Yes, Ketchianya is from Castlemilk. That's right.
Oh, there he is.
Oh, yeah, he agrees.
Ketchianya. Do you know who else? Jimmy Calderwood.
Oh, come on, man.
No, yes.
You're going to say that name on this? Look, I'm going to kick him out. Sorry, boys. I'm going to kick him out.
But all those superstars to Castlemilk, and then you've just basically ruined it all with one name.
Sorry, I'm gagged. I've gagged.
Oh, God, you've said it now. It's recorded. You can't take it back. You can't take it. That's it. It's there.
Yes,
in all history.
He's gagged. I'm sorry. Right, carry on, boys.
Back to our host of this episode, Dr.
He did
literally.
Come on,
Dr. J, get some order.
Want to get some order? All right, let's
do the host, yeah.
All right. I
fucking sort it out, man.
For a minute there, my chair and my whip were taken from me.
On the one show, everyone's...
So here's a serious question for you guys. Against the Huns, you go with Dembele or Griffiths?
Griffiths.
I think we'll go Ballboys first here, and we will go... Dembele
has scored more goals against the Huns than Joey Garner has all season. Get up, guys. Moving on to Colonial. Pass the ball. Hot totty.
Lee Griffiths all day long, man. That boy is what he wants to score goals. I've noticed when Dembele gets into position and he holds the ball up well, but when he's taking his shot, he's not taking his shots properly. They're weak, they're straight at the keeper, and he's slightly out of form. I'd have Lee Griffiths in myself.
I'd echo that.
Oh, and Akun?
I'd echo that as well.
No,
Griffiths deserves a chance, man. He's waited patiently all season, you know what I mean? A lot of players
against them as well.
Spit their dummy out.
All against them.
Yeah, he deserves a chance more than
Andy. So, I'd like to be a countermeasure to your Griffiths chant is that Dembele does a lot more work than McGriffiths does. I'm not disputing the fact that the guy scored 40.
You're right, he does.
Dembele does a lot more work, and he introduces a lot more players in the team. And since he's played in the team, the midfield just scored more goals than it did last season.
Can I just say something? I was reading a Hun posted up Dembele's only scored this many goals, and it said because we were all got and it was like the top 10 was five Celtic players. Did you notice, like, if somebody had scored six, they were the bottom of all the guys that had scored six.
Aye.
We scored 10, the bottom of the guys that scored 10. So anyway, go for it.
Stats. Stato.
I say Dembele, but that's just me.
I've got to get this out of my system, but I did a search for Castle Milk. So Wikipedia came to the rescue. So right, so anyway, here we go. Notable residents of Castle Milk. So yeah, Anya is there. You got Islam Firouz.
Yes.
Islam Firouz.
Islam Firouz.
Arthur Graham played for Leeds. I was growing up, he was a football player. And Eddie Gray, Frank Gray, Ray Houghton. Some other people, Aidan McGeady, Jim McAnally.
Aidan McGeady.
Benny Slaven, he played for Albion Rovers. But anyway, it takes a bit of a turn, guys. It does take a bit of a turn, right? So anyway, Charlie Miller. Charlie Miller, right? Right, now, this cancels everything, right? And I'm taking this from Wikipedia. Famous notable residents of Castle Milk. You ready for this? One and only David King. Dave King from Castle Milk.
He
attended Alan Glen School in the city after passing a bursary examination. So there you go, guys. That certainly cancels everything out. Castle Milk, you can take it.
Own that fact. And shove it. We are actually helping on the demise of Rangers.
Aye, well, you'll thank us in a few months for Dave King.
No, Rangers, we are helping in the demise of Rangers International.
Can you just tell us, did Dave McCarthy for Castle Milk? Because I know he was, I went to school.
Is this on your wiki, Pete?
Yeah.
Dave McCarthy is from Castle Milk.
Who trusts a businessman for Castle Milk? Rangers, there you go, get out of here.
So, all right, so let's go. If you guys listen to the show, we do something called over and under. So what I want to do is I want to give you guys some over and unders. They're totally made up. None of them are real. I don't think you can actually get a Bet Fred on this or Paddy Power, but I'm going to I have about four or five of them, so I'll throw them out to you. Over under 7.5%. That would be the chance that you give us or give Celtic to go invincible undefeated this season. Who wants to take that one over or under? More of a chance or less of a chance? Ewan, you there?
7.5%.
Mm-hmm. Would you go higher or lower than that?
I'd go higher.
You think more than
7.5?
You think so?
Yeah. Yeah.
Mark Ball, what do you think?
It's our strongest chance. It's our strongest chance we've had. I mean, the way we're playing, like we don't look like beat by anybody at the moment. So I would say it's higher than 7.5%.
Higher than 7.5% to be able to finish with undefeated.
Who is lower than 7.5%? Johnny? Is that you fucking a monkey? What are you doing?
Nah, man, I don't really understand the question. Like 7.5 out of 100?
Yes.
Yeah, that's 7.5%.
That was... I thought percents were at 50, sorry. No, higher. I'd say like, fucking, I don't know, 50%, 60%.
Woo!
60.
Who would say a better than 50% chance they go undefeated this year? Who would agree to that?
What's the question again?
Who would say that a greater than 50% chance they'll go undefeated this year?
Sorry, I better go. Sadly, we go what this week?
Undefeated.
Undefeated this season?
Yes.
I would say highly probable. I'm going to say around. I'm hoping for an invincible season this season. There you go.
So you'd say lower?
I'd say around 80%, 75, 80%.
Wow. You guys are really, really... Wow. I find that interesting, considering... considering it doesn't happen all that often. When's the last time you see it? What's the last team that you guys remember going undefeated in the season? Would it be Arsenal?
Arsenal, yeah. Arsenal, most definitely.
And so from then to now...
Castle Milk in the year 2000.
Castle Milk.
That's the team.
Pat, what do you think of the chances of Celtic going undefeated?
Long. I would have thought we had a really good run under O'Neill. Would have been, but we did lose games at the end. But my only concern is that with Rodgers, at the minute he's bringing in youth for a bit of experience, and obviously the utilize the squad depth. But when he's doing things like that, that's the only time I would be concerned about winning and losing games.
Yeah, I'm with you, Belfast. I reckon to achieve that, I reckon this season would be amazing. And I think it's a really, really hard thing to do. It's, again, you're talking about player motivation. You're talking about, you know, trying to blood sort of younger players. And if Rodgers is right and telling the truth about trying to, you know, bring these young players through and give them experience, then eventually you're going to slip up somewhere. And in truth, it's one of those ones. When we did it with Lennon a while back, I think it was actually a detriment towards the end of the year, because they were trying to achieve that, whereas you weren't really getting the young players coming through and giving a chance, because there was that sort of target set. So if it is true about giving players a chance, I reckon in a roundabout way you kind of want it to happen sooner rather than later, because then it does give you a chance to bring those young guys in.
Right.
Did you see that season? Well, man, I thought that was one of the worst seasons to be going to Celtic ever. It was terrible to watch, man. I was there the game we lost. It was the more Aberdeen it was. That was a sort of
cup game. Oh yeah.
Yeah, that was the Aberdeen game. That was a rocket from like almost 30 yards out to beat Forster.
Is that the Scottish Cup, or did they not beat it? How did they lose in that league?
They lost in the league. It was like on a Wednesday night. It was a Wednesday night game or something.
Pataudry as well.
Aye.
Aberdeen beat us in the cup. The first game I ever took my son to. The last game I ever took my son to.
So here goes another one for you guys. So right now we have a 31 goal difference, right?
Hey, what do you think? What do you think, Dr. J?
I think there's like 5% chance or less.
Oh, you fucking negative bastard.
Yeah. Do you want to explain why, Dr. J?
What'd you say?
Do you want to explain the rationale behind that 5%?
The reason why I say that is because the chances of it happening, because it happens so rarely, A. B, if Brendan, like as Pat said, Brendan's going to bring some younger players through, and that's going to have an effect somewhere. And I think there's a chance somewhere along the line. I mean, that would mean getting a result every night. I just know Europe, you know, I just have this feeling that a chance of that happening is going to be really, really rare. It just doesn't happen all that often. I just don't think it's going to happen. I just don't. I mean, if it does, listen, I'll be the first person to be excited. And I'd love to be wrong, but I just see it happening the other way. I just see, you know, a loss here or there on a Wednesday night somewhere, you know, to Ross County wouldn't surprise me.
If we get through January, I'm all for it, man. It will happen. But January's a bit of a bastard.
But I mean, would you rather have a season where we're undefeated, or a season where we drop points but we actually do a treble?
Treble.
Exactly. So for me, it would be a bonus on top of getting the Scottish Cup, because I'd love us to win the Scottish Cup. We haven't won enough of them, so.
We've actually won the most Scottish Cups, I think.
Right. I know, but I'm saying we've not had a great record in Cups. Even under Lennon, we didn't do that well. Bolton were putting us out and stuff like that. And just so.
I think now we have a manager that can manage and juggle the team around the suit, and he's as
Belfast
things you're saying.
You walking your duck, Belfast boy?
Oh, hi, yeah. I'm out curb crawling here at the minute. Does anybody want some Bernie pee-pee? I'm actually on my way home from work. So yeah, but no, there's no fun to be had tonight. Curb crawling.
So, Bob, I think you asked the right question. The question would be, what do you think is a greater chance? Obviously, getting the treble. What would you give a percentage of winning? I mean, we're going to win the league. That's done. I mean, we've already won League Cup. What percentage of Scottish Cup chances do you think? Would it be 85% or higher? What do you think?
I'm saying higher. Yeah, I'm saying higher than 80%.
How awesome is it to think that they're going to win the 100% treble?
We've got to win it, man. We've got to fucking win it.
I think that we're sort of... We can only be beaten by ourselves, you know, when the Hun with the whistle. I think that with a manager who's switched on enough to manage the squad rotation well enough throughout the season to see us over the line, I think it's highly probable. I would say 95%, like.
95% because Rodgers is the only guy that, only manager that I've seen in recent years that can actually manage that we need to bring in, but yet still get the result we need.
I manage a squad, but still rotate the squad enough who can be fighting with Patrick Thistle on a Wednesday night, Tuesday night, whatever it was.
Yeah.
I agree with that, man. That seems to be like unreachable for any manager. Every other club, like when Bayern Munich won pump everybody in Germany, it's like, aye, did they drop half their team when they punched Darmstadt? Who the fuck's Darmstadt? That's like your hand.
Darmstadt?
Aye, Colonial Darmstadt. What, you know, trying to...
Aye, the fucking centre forward for Castle Milk. He's called the hat trick.
I think
is that not a borough in Castle Milk, Darmstadt?
Colonial. Sober up.
I thought that was gay.
Sober up.
I think the team have to be a bit careful. I don't know. I missed the Dundee game. It's the only game I've missed. I was working early in the Sunday morning, so I couldn't stay up for it. But they have been a little bit sort of down in the past couple of games. So what you kind of don't want is that going into the new Glasgow derby match. Undefeated, that's the one you don't want to lose it in, you know, whether it's a draw or a win, don't really care, you know, crumble them.
Well, apparently there's this big storm that may brew and that might jeopardise the New Zealand derby being played, Storm Isabel or something, but I'd be all for it. Like, see if they had the Old Firm game after the break, I think that'd be better, man. Like you said, we are in poor form, but we're a bit tired, and obviously they've not played about fucking half a minute games we had. And if we were to get a bit of a longer break, I'd be all for playing the fucking, and also not having it on Ogwene as well. Apart from a Colonial Year's plan.
Is that a storm coming in exactly like at New Year?
Storm Barbara or something it's called.
Storm Isabel.
No, Barbara.
It's
coming soon. In
the state of fucking Ibrox as well, like they won't be able to, for fucking safety reasons, they won't be able to play it if there's a storm. The fucking crowd safety. I'm not even taking the piss, like, honestly.
The hard hats will need to come in because
that has to happen. The hard hats and the high viz.
Well, like, look, no, but see, be honest, like, see if the supporters show up with hard hats, we're not going to get let in with hard hats. Let's face facts, because they won't let us in with hard hats. So we need to come up with another thing that we're going to get let in, because we're not going to let us in with hard tats. Because as soon as we score the first goal, the hard tats are going to hit the park the same way.
Yeah, give Mikael Ustig will have something to wear in this time. Save a beat ball.
Exactly. We fucking need them against them as well, because you know what they're going to do. They're just going to boot us up and down the park anyway, so we might as well wear them.
That's all we have.
Pat, well, Pat, what were you going to say about the weather,
that
Pat?
That was always their tactic. If you look at all the Sevco Rangers games in the past, all they ever did was basically just come out and just basically kick us off the park. They've always done it. That's how Rangers have always played against us, you know. So,
sober up, Colonial.
Pat, what were you going to say about the weather? You were saying, I was going to say something.
That... I think, no, I remember reading it the other day, because I was the same thing. Is this meant to be hitting sort of towards the derby match? But from what I remember, what I read, I think it was it's the next game that they play is when it's going to hit. So it's we're kind of the game after, if you know what I mean. So if the damage is going to be hit, it's going to be, I can't remember who they play, Partick or Ross County or something like that. And then I think it's after that.
Hopefully it's fucking Inverness and a big boat comes over and fucking wipes out their whole team. Just blew over the walls.
In the Hamilton game. So I think the only fears the storm hitting is going to cancel the Hamilton game in Christmas Eve. I think that's the only kind of problem.
Oh, right, okay, cool.
But on the other hand, this podcast has been sponsored by Custom Cairo Solutions.
Sober up, will you? For goodness sake, man. That was uncalled for. That's just off topic.
Yeah, no, I appreciate it to the one other chiropractor that might be listening somewhere in Zimbabwe. Yes, thank you.
There's not going to be anybody listening. Take it from me, there ain't anybody I'm going to listen. I'll get the first 5 minutes of it and go,
nah. So, Dr. J, who else is going to go then in January?
Who's going to go? Oh, that's easy. You're looking at Bailly. Apparently now FA won't leave. Did you guys read that?
He must go.
You're fucking kidding me.
He won't leave. You know why? He needs his British passport. He needs to be here 5 years. He won't leave.
Maybe send him to Castle Milk on loan.
Yeah, it's in the Castle Milk on loan. He won't leave. So, obviously, Common's out. I wouldn't bother me if Boyata left. You know, that whole thing.
Chifty
out. Yeah.
But when you say go in January, are you talking selling them or are you talking potential loans? Because there's a whole...
Loans as well. Pat, like you look at the fringe players, so Scott Allen's coming back into the folder, let's be honest. He's not going to get a game that's set of fucking anywhere. You know, so what happens there?
Ronnie Dyler was like that. Look, the squad's big, and we've not really lost a lot of those players. I mean, we've only got rid of a few, so that we're still left with the same bloated squad. I mean, Chris Collins is gone, but I mean, Diffie's, Ambrose, and they're talking about Boyata as well.
Boyata, yeah.
Logan Bailly as well.
All right, yeah.
So there's say the guts of maybe 4, 5, 6 people going, whether it's sold on or loaned out. I seen today that Rogers has obviously Paddy Roberts is moving on, but Rogers today has rubbished the Snodgrass move. Anybody else? Anything else other than McCarthy?
Nagby. Well, they'll go to Dr. J. Dr. J's...
Murphy, good cast.
Darlington Nagby is not from the US. Sorry, I was going to ask Dr. J because he's from the States, but apparently Darlington Nagby is from Castlemilk as well.
So. Yes, he's from Castlemilk. Exactly.
Is he Portland Timbers? He's meant to be really good.
Yeah, he's like everyone else. His YouTube thing looks really, really good, but after that, you know, whatever.
But I look really, really good on YouTube.
Yes, exactly. There's a couple plays here and there. But you know what, though? To be honest with you, I mean,
Paddy McCourt looked amazing on YouTube.
Paddy McCourt was amazing. But the only thing the only question I have for that, did Celtic ever face a riot when they let him go?
Huh?
Was there ever a riot when they let Paddy McCourt go?
I think no, Dr. J.
Yes. Yes, remember? Don't sell McCourt.
Dr. G, pay attention to us.
I can hear you.
We're your guests. Come on.
I can hear your guests. This is way, way more than I expected. No, I think there's a really, really interesting point that you can deal with when it comes down to Darlington Nagbe, and that is whether you like him or not, there is a financial portion to what he brings, especially if Bruce Arena brings him back into the national team. To have a Celtic player, that would bring a little bit more marketability to him in the U.S. I'd love to see a U.S. national team player play for them, just so it would be brought up. But
Dr. J, can I ask a question? I was in Orlando over Halloween there, and I went into the new Balance store, and there was no football replica jerseys whatsoever. Is that normal?
Yeah, the store you're in was their outlet store. They don't have any of that stuff.
Yeah, it was, yeah.
In fact, there's one here in Myrtle Beach, and I went in there the other day with a Celtic sweatshirt on. The guy working there was like, "Where did you get one of those? I want one." He didn't even know they existed.
Yeah, it's a fucking shame, like, isn't it?
I mean, if you go to their website, they're selling it. So, you know, they're selling it to people who go to New Balance's website. So I guess that's good.
Yeah, definitely.
Was it on the New Balance? Did anybody see the Celtic View competition? Did that competition? You buy the Celtic View. You went for the New Balance competition. Do you see the colour of the boots that they were advertising as a competition?
Yeah, red and blue.
And blue? Did you understand the whole stature of this fucking club?
I think New Balance are no good enough for us, man. Like, I don't think they're good. Like, even the fucking strips you buy are shit quality. Like, you wash them twice and they go all fucking bally. Like, I've got a bit of chubbing and like, they don't fucking fit me at all. Like, they're actually like a fucking fat wee bear when I'm wearing them. Even though I get a fucking size up, they just don't fit.
Well, it's really, listen, Johnny, the way you wash clothes in a river with pounding them with a rock, no shirt's going to actually live through that.
A wee fat baboon, that's what you're like.
Jason Rubbish.
Jason Rubbish. A wee fat baboon. I've never bought a Home Balance tap. I bought the
Home Balance?
Home Balance. Are they the fucking knockoff Castle Milk fucking brand? It's your Home Balance socks, yeah. The Home Balance.
Sorry, I was thinking the Homeboys, man. They can all get it up there or not.
Fuck them and all.
You're obsessed with that. Obsessed with Homeboys, come on.
I want to fucking join their podcast, man.
Yeah, next question. Next question is,
do you want me to know?
Virgil van Dijk is seeming to be on the move in January. Fine, with John Park out of the way, do you expect that money to be reinvested in the club?
Yeah, can I just
silly question?
In first, Cooler Costa, Joker Costa, bring on your rematch, wee man. On you go.
I didn't catch that one. That one, I've been doing good up until now. Thanks. What did you say?
Insight. We'll take you over to the Ballboys now for some insight into the transfer window.
You're signing something called Joel Acosta. Is that what's happening?
No.
I'll just descend now. You see the spiral. You can see it sliding slowly downwards. So you'll just get the odd random word shouted out. Colonial.
Castle milk.
Colonial.
All right.
Up fast. You're drunk. And Colonial's kid on his nose. That's the real embarrassment here.
Oh, boys.
Colonial's on the first flight back to Glasgow.
I'm coming home next Christmas. I'm getting off the plane and I'm getting a taxi to Castle Milk. And you and me, Dan, we're gonna have a big hug. You're gonna take me down to Chapman's.
Why you coming? Colonial Ballboys special. Yeah,
yep, that's next. That's next.
So Brian asked a question. So who thinks we're gonna invest money minus the Belfast? I mean, minus the ball boys going in here. Who do you think, how much, how, not just, you know, do you think we're going to spend money? How much money do you guys think we're going to spend?
Sorry, Dr. J, what did you say?
How much money do you think we're going to spend? If we're going to, or are we going to spend any money at all in January?
In the transfer window, that
in January.
January.
Aye.
In January.
Most six.
Six? Fucking hell, I say.
No, I think most six, that's collectively. Darlington, Nagby, I can almost assure that they're probably number three. So it's leaving another £3 million for another player, and it's probably another youth player.
FRWE. Yeah. RWE.
What are you talking about?
What do you mean? That's
what's the boy that plays for Crystal Palace? He was rumoured to be signing Jordan Mooch.
Jordan Rhodes as well.
I've not heard.
What is this Jordan Rhodes chat, by the way? I can't find the link to that anywhere.
I've heard a lot of people talking about Jordan Rhodes, but look, I've never actually seen anything on Twitter to actually back us up. Well, I've not actually seen anything on Twitter or Facebook or anything actually saying that Jordan Rhodes has even talked to Celtic.
On that website.
I saw the other day they wanted, they're going to want $9 million for Jordan Rhodes.
No, but I'd say £6 million possibly the most that we've used in the transfer window. £3 million is going to Darlington Nagby, that's we're going to sign him.
Is he any Dr. J? Have you seen him play? Because you watch some MLS, right? You and Rev and that. How good is he?
He's one of the players that you know of. I mean, I've seen him before. Whether or not he's, you know, is he going to push James Forrest? I mean, he looks about as fast as, if not faster than Forrest. So, I mean, he's a winger, he's an attacking winger. I think,
right wing, though. So who would keep replacing the team right now?
Forrest. Because at the end of the year, Paddy goes back, so it's just Forrest on the right wing.
Or Patrick Roberts is going, obviously.
Yeah, does anyone think he's going to stay?
Did you, Colonial, did you see the tweet in the chat room by David Boy saying, you sound drunk as fuck?
he's done Buckfast, he's been on Buckfast for the last 3 hours. What does he know? I love it when people have been sitting drinking Bucky for 3 hours, turn around and say you're drunk. That's magic that is.
You're steaming by the way. 6 a.m. I was drinking whiskey at 6 a.m. starts pulling you up if you're drinking too much. That's when you know.
Okay, guys, I'm calling it a night. I've reached my destination. It's been a pleasure. I've thoroughly enjoyed it.
Belfast boy, thanks very much.
Belfast,
yes.
Like to come on an episode of the Ballboys sometime soon.
I'll get Bruce Willis on with me.
Tell these dog guys, yeah. Get to them, and we'll get them.
Yeah, we'll have to make it happen. I have to arrange with Chris to do something after Christmas, so I need to get that tied up with him, hopefully. So we'll do something after that, definitely.
Message you soon, man, because we've got something bigger in episode, which is
Tuesday.
Definitely.
Right.
Okay. Right. Good night, my man. Leave it to you.
Sounds like a plan.
Good night, man. Take care. God bless.
Happy Christmas to you all.
Well, you take it easy.
Take it easy, lad. Slam. Heel, heel.
Hello.
Actually, boys, that's maybe an appropriate point. It's early morning here. The kids are up and about. Almost Christmas, so things to do, people to see, and all that. So I might call it quits as well. Leave you guys to it, but been a pleasure. You and I'll be over your way in a couple of weeks' time, mate. So hope that South Island weather's doing all right in New Zealand.
Yeah, mate, look me up if you can move up. You're on holiday.
Yeah, I'm going to South Island though, so traveling around down there. So
I'll enjoy.
And the very very off chance you're out and about. Bit of touring going on down there, so. Nice. Thanks for the invite, guys. It's a kind of an impromptu, but we're going to try and sort something out for a half a world away before end of the year. So it's in the pipeline. We're going to try and get a few other people from around Australia involved as well, but we'll have to see how we go. It's just that time of the year, try to get people nailed down for a chat at night time and stuff. It's getting pretty hard, but we'll try our best. If not, we'll see you guys in the new year, and yeah, have a good one.
Hey, Pat. All right. Pat, can you hear me?
No, I can't. No, what's it? What?
We need you for a wee minute. Just a wee tiny minute. Can you touch with the ball boys? Can you tweet us? We need you to record a wee voice.
We'll get in contact with a direct message, and we'll
got something arranged for our next solo podcast, which is basically us getting it right up the homeboy, so I know you want to hear it. I'll do a rematch. We'll tweet us the new, and Mark will get in touch with you.
I'll give you the details.
Right, yes. I want to hear from half the world away, well done, Ballboys, for getting this right up the homeboy.
some people call that a spoiler, but yeah, send it through, and I'm sure one of us can sort it out for you. No problem.
No problem.
Nobody's listening
to this
right now.
Of course not.
That's not true. Grimbelli is listening, and Big Daddy Pedro is listening. I think Lisa Miller might be listening. So we've got three friends.
Dave King, probably, because he's from Castle Milk.
He's from Castle Milk.
And my lawyer, Paul Baxendale, as well.
Colonial.
I'm calling it quits. All right, have a good one. Enjoy the rest of the podcast.
See you, man.
Thanks,
mate.
Thanks, Pat. Thanks, guys. Take care.
Enjoy the next 6 hours. That's what you just said.
Who's actually on the pod now?
So what's left is let's see, Johnny, Ewan, and you guys.
Hail!
And look, and just on cue.
Hail from Athens, Georgia, aka Castle Milk.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Castle Milk, Georgia.
It's just right down the street, man.
That's okay. Good segue on to the next content. Anybody see this Little Mix Joe Gardner competition for number one in Britain?
Oh my god, fucking hell, man. It's
let's get this out of the way.
Can you explain this to me? I don't get top 40 radio in Scotland, so explain to me what's going on.
Right.
Wait. See people in America, do they know what a Rangers is?
What a Rangers is?
No, does everybody in America know what a Rangers is?
No, we try and make this as Hun-free as possible.
Right, so do you know what a Little Mix is?
No.
Right, well, you're on good grounds here, so you've never heard of a Rangers, you've never heard of a Little Mix. Have you ever heard of, X Factor?
We have a version here, yes.
Yes.
Right. Here's so, Mark, to give you the rundown, because I'm away for a piss.
Aye, so basically what it is, right, Little Mix was in X Factor. I'm sure they might have won it at one
point. No, they didn't even win it.
Second, right? So anyway, Little Mix is four lassies that have been a pop group.
Can I just say as well? Right. Three good looking lassies, one wasn't so good.
No, I'd say four good.
The fat man?
I thought you were away for a piss.
I know, I thought you were away for a piss.
Yeah, what? Yeah, did you hear the conundrum on Twitter? It was. Alright, sorry, on you go.
Joe.
Let the man finish.
Gardner song.
It's better looking than the fat man. Anyway, I'm away for a piss.
Hey, thank fuck. Joe Gardner versus Little Mix for this. Britain's number one for Xmas or whatever the fuck it is, right? But did anybody see, I've sent a link out for Sky Sports, and it's a group of Rangers fans singing this Glad All Over. Did any of you see it?
I've seen it.
Aye.
Yes.
Aye. So they're pushing this for number one in Britain, right? So Crystal Palace has jumped on the bandwagon, and apparently Tottenham have jumped on the bandwagon to try and get this to number one.
Aye, up him. Aye, he's just showing up at the toilet. On this video, you've got two old grannies singing Glad All Over. Did you see the state of them? Two old women singing Glad All Over on Sky Sports. And then after this, you've got two guys, mid-20s guys, one guy singing, and then you've got a fucking cheerleader in the background waving his fucking horn. It is unbelievably bad. And this is them trying to get Rangers relevant in this climate. Honestly, God, it is fucking unbelievable. Honestly.
See, the worst, there's a bit on Twitter, and it was like, it's a conundrum, and it was a guy who was like, if you have the choice of beating the Tags 3-0, or Joey Garner getting, let me say that again, right. So if you had a chance of beating the Tags 3-0, or shagging each of the birds in the little mix, how would you celebrate Rangers' second goal?
What is that?
It was just like you got a chance of fucking four girls in a girl band at the same time, or scoring Rangers. And then there was some fucking absolute space cadet that after it was like he was like, I'd fuck each of them in the ass, and then I'd I'd come for the fourth just as about there, and then I'd celebrate the fourth goal just as they're about to celebrate theirs or something like that.
Aye.
Did you know anyone of you see that? It was on Twitter earlier.
That was my line, mate.
Oh, fuck, sorry, man.
But see, to be honest, like, this is the only thing that they have actually got to push for number one.
Highlight of the hunt season.
Aye, but yes, they're gonna get fucked off four young lassies as well as they're gonna get fucked off us in Hogmanay. Basic facts, they're trying to push for any number one that they can get, yet they're gonna get beat to any number one that they go for. They're just not a number one team.
But they don't live in the same reality as us anyway. So as far as they're concerned, it's just they're in another world altogether. Really, I mean, that song is probably the worst chant football song I've heard, and like from any team, even down in the EPL. And they've got some shite songs down in the EPL. But when I saw that link, I mean, I like laughing at them, but I was embarrassed for them, to be honest.
Actually worse than the Stockport song, wasn't it?
Oh,
and that's fucking saying something, like.
Aye, look, you can sit and watch the Stockport one and have a wee chuckle yourself, but see me sit and watch them on Sky Sports trying to sing this Glad All Over.
It's fucking
unbelievably bad, man.
And honestly, let's face it, they're sad all over. Sad all over, we are. Sad all over.
Sad all over, we are. Oh, you should get that going against them. They'll need to do like a contrary one for when they play in Hogmanay. If the game goes ahead, like just to fucking rip the piss out of them.
Well, let's see.
We use sad all over or something like that.
I was going to ask you, what are your favourite all-time chants for players? Because mine was always the Canio, you know, if the ball's in the net and it's not George Cadet, it's the Canio. That was my favourite. That was always my favourite chant from the fans, you know. I loved the way it just went through the whole, you know, went through the whole team, Andy Tom and Van Hooydonk. What was your favourite in years?
On me, that would be mine. That's my first ever. When I was growing up being a Celtic fan, that was the song that kind of always stuck in my head. I was a young boy when Cadet played for Celtic. That was the kind of song stuck in my head. It always stuck in my head, supporting Celtic.
I quite like the Efrain Juarez one, like, the boy, he comes from Mexico, he gets a goal, he scores a goal, Efrain Juarez, Celtic's number four. I fucking love that one, but...
I don't even remember that one.
Well, that's the 6 months.
I don't know the words.
Basically, Scottish Sinclair, I don't know the fucking words. He's a words, Mark. I don't know them.
Oh, that was
he's wonderful.
Supertramp, that's that Supertramp Logical song.
No,
no,
a Scooter, Logical song.
Scooter, where are you from?
Supertramp.
So none of you know the words to that song?
No.
No, missed that one.
Yeah, it's like, oh, Scotty Sinclair, when he gets to the... He's like, fine like lightning. No, I don't care, I don't know. I thought that...
This podcast is going down in a hurry. Hey, so Chris,
it didn't even start out that good anyway.
Okay.
Well, Chris is here. Chris can keep us right now. Chris is commanding.
Back to our
correspondent in Athens, Georgia, Chris.
A.K.A. Castle Milk.
Castle Milk.
How are you? How is the Fenian Gandalf? What have you been up to, mate?
Just getting ready for Christmas, trying to get as much work done as possible, and, just trying to keep my head above water. But everything's good. Everything's wonderful. It's fantastic to be a Tim. I mean,
who would you play? Who would you play in the old firm? The Sevco game. There we go. I've so already said
you,
firm.
How dare you use...
who would you play up front, Griffiths or Dembele?
I like Dembele for his physical presence, but I also think that Griffiths is going to be hungry for scoring some goals. So, that's going to be a tough call. If it was me, though, I think I would start Dembele and put, bring Griffiths on in, the 60th minute or so, because I think he gives you a different look that Dembele's would be beating everybody up in the box for an extended period of time, and I think that's what you want, especially in a game like that. Is like you just want to punch them in the balls as much as possible. So, but I mean, it could go either way, really.
Yeah, bring him on in the 67th minute.
There you go.
Hopefully, we won't need it by then.
Well, no. Well, Scott Sinclair is already on a hat trick at that point.
So, what do you guys think? So, just not to jump past Saturday, but playing the Huns. Do you think it's how can we say this? Do you think it's a similar 5-1 beating? Or do you think it's more like the one? You think it's more like a 1-0?
Last mark.
No, I think it may be a closer game than with the 5-1. But I think the scoreline probably won't reflect the game. 4-1. But I think we might score another. I'll put it there. I actually think we might score another 5-1, but the game might be a wee bit closer. The gulf might have closed. No, it's no, definitely closed. 5-1.
See that. The golf might have closed. I punched him right in the face when he said that. So Mark's talking through 1-2.
Definitely no. The golf is still there. 5-0, I would say.
Yeah, I think we're going to go to the eye.
Do you honestly believe we're going to go there and win 5? Do you honestly for a second think the SFA would allow that to happen?
I'll be honest. I'm a bit skeptical just because of our run of form. We've took a foot off the gas a wee bit the last games, and also because of the congestion, the amount of games we've played. Like we've played like fucking 9 games in the last 4 weeks or something like that. Like it's a lot of extra pressure. Whereas they've had a lot more time to prepare for it. So I'm not saying we're going to get beat or that, but I'm just saying I'm a lot more skeptical than I have of any other Old Firm game this season. But I said that the last one too. I don't know. I don't think we'll fucking do them over the ground after, but I think it'll be a lot closer this time than the previous two.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm with you. I believe that's the way it's going to go down also. I really do. I think it'll be a league match 3-1, something like that.
I don't even think they'll get a goal, to be quite honest with you. Like, I know, like, they're shouting about Gardner and fucking...
Aye, they've got Joey Gardner, they've got...
Joey Gardner, they've got... Joey Gardner, they've got... Bingo,
of all the songs to use as a chant, it's your granny's bingo song. Sad.
No, but see if you look at the team for the past couple of games, it's no been our strongest side. We've been playing a squad rotation system against these SPL teams, and I know it looks as if we're scraping out results, but we're dominating these results. And last season, if you look at the way Bonnie Dahlia played them, we were scraping these results.
Yep.
Right. This time, I'm not scraping these results. We're confidently winning 1-0, 2-0, 3-0.
Right, I agree. Right, here's it, Paul. Right, we were at all three of these games, man. Right, genuinely, like, you played teams against these guys last season. Like, I don't know if you've seen it last season. We drew nothing each three times at Parkhead. We got beat half Motherwell after taking the lead 2-1. That's never happened at Parkhead as long as I've been a fucking spectator at Parkhead.
No.
That's never happened. Like, we've never drew nothing each three times. Like, way back, well into the 90s. Like, it's just never happened, man. Like, Ronnie Dyla done it. It's like, well, people are like, I won the league, and that's like, don't be fucking ridiculous. He's won the league, and it's like, aye, but. It came at a cost, man, which is a, like, pure domination was the cost. And do I know what? She went with Brendan Rodgers in. Pure domination is like what we came up with. And it's like, aye, okay, right, we'll win a league game 1-0 against Partick Thistle.
But we'll dominate that 1-0 one.
But, and all said, man, see the three games in a row, we never exerted ourselves in any one of them. It's like, this game is a struggle. And I was at every one, man. Like, we never, like, fucking, like, right, should be torn on it. We need to keep the ball, and this is... No, because, like, you just make subtle substitutions, and you're like, right, let's win it. Aye. Because, do you know why we're going to win it? Because we're fucking 10 times a teammate, all these cunts.
We've got Brendan Rodgers, and he loves the support.
Because we've got Brendan Rodgers, we've got... Rodgers, we've got... Brendan Rodgers.
There you go, there's the chant. That's exactly the chant we need at Ibrox.
I've got Brendan Rodgers. No, but
I would never go to a game at Ibrox in all my life.
The boss is, we've got a
confidence. I wouldn't want to go there.
Wins now.
Ibrox can suck it.
Even though that it's 1-0 wins, it's a confident 1-0 win. And there was no doubt through that part of the game that we were going to win that. They were never going to score a goal. And us as Celtic fans knew that we've got this confidence about our team now that Brendan Rodgers has brought in about the supporters, and
it's a great Carter
and the great supporter and the great support is will put the belief in the players that we never had under Ronnie, and we will always have confidence to win games. And see, coming up against the Zombies and Hogmanay, I have every right to believe that we are going to scalp the shit out of these Zombies.
Here is how confident we are. Mark has already promised a post episode, a post hun scalping live.
Unscubbery live.
Unscubbery live.
Unscubbery.
I've got nothing to do with this.
Aye. Unscubbery live podcast at 5 minutes past kickoff.
The next big HailHailMedia get together.
But that is a belief that I've got in Brendan Rodgers and the Celtic team now. I've no other doubt that we are going to scalp every other team in this SPL right now.
I mean, if you think about if it had been Aberdeen or any of these other sides, or even Sevco in the last few weeks that had been getting 1-0 victories, the media would have been talking about consistency. They'd have been talking about grinding out results. They'd been talking about, a 14-point lead with a game in hand, 70. But because it's us, it's like Paul Larkin said, he had a tweet out saying, like, it's just this negative tone from the mainstream media. It's just like, any chance they'll get to try and hamper us, and they've not figured out yet that it doesn't work. It's like, you're just throwing fuel on the fire, because it just makes people, Brendan Rodgers gets it, he'll just use all that. He'll say, look what they're saying, they're just trying to pick holes in us, and it's not going to work, you know what I mean? Like, James Traynor and the idiots that spin all this bullshit at Ibrox and the Daily Record and all that pish, it's never worked. It never has worked, but it's the only way they know how. So I can't wait to beat them at Castle Grayskull, because I think that's going to put them back in the box for the rest of the season.
I was just going to ask you that. Do you think a good scalping at that point in time just breaks whatever resistance left? We go on by win the league by 40 points.
I think so. If you beat them Ibrox, I think they know that. It's over anyway. It could be a 17. Can you remember the last time either us or them ahead by 17 points was overcome? I don't think.
You're going to hit 55 at Christmas. They were planning on hitting 55 over the season. You know what I mean?
I don't quite think that's what they meant, but okay.
Ballboys and Ballboys are Celtic and Rangers.
Oh my God! Do you think they win the league by 40 points plus?
Rangers have been chasing this 55 for 5 seasons now, right? And they had their chance to actually implement this chasing 55. And we've hit 55 points before they can even get going.
That's going to be ugly.
But that's why they've that's why they've got songs about Joey Garland. They make all this shite up on the side to just keep themselves amused, because there's nothing happening for them.
No, Chris, what do you think? Chris, do you think we win the league by 40 points?
I genuinely thought you were talking about the Homeboys and Ballboys.
Oh. Oh, for God's sake. Chris, do you think the Ballboys will win the rap battle by 40 votes?
Much.
And the Homeboys are here to take it all. That's all I heard. Because we are glad all over.
So sad. So, one more thing for you guys. Let me ask you this. Did you see the comment from Brendan about the little Dembele, Karamoko Dembele?
Who, sorry?
The 13-year-old kid, Dembele, the little one.
Oh, Dembele?
Yeah.
Karamoko Dembele, yeah.
They said that he would see him sooner or later. Do you think he plays before he's 15?
See, being boys from Casimir, we've already been stung with that. The man who mentioned Farouj, man, so we've already been stung with that. So see, when it comes to Karamoka Dembele, we couldn't give a fuck, because Farouj has already stung us, man. Farouj was the first guy for Casper who you'd genuinely believe was hitting stardom.
Aye, but now he's playing in Belgium, second tier, getting 30 grand a week.
Could you imagine James McCarthy never got a shout for Hamilton? He's a better player, is he not? You're
bringing up James McCarthy again.
No, because that was the same. That was the same generation of player, wasn't it?
Aye. No.
So no, they weren't it.
Full year, yeah.
I bet they were in the same St. Margaret Mary's team.
No, they weren't.
Oh, I bet you they were, but you can't prove they weren't. go Google it, because I was not because you're wrong.
But on to the new Dembele that's coming through.
Always right.
On to the new Dembele that's coming
through. Because I googled it and I found it was right.
I've heard that there's a lot of...
And I was nerding a wee bit late. Turns out they all played together.
I've heard there's a lot of EPL teams in for this new Dembele. And as long as we get the compensation that we're guaranteed for this transfer, I'm no too bothered.
It's pure right.
I'm not too bothered about it, but I would like to see the guy, the young boy, actually.
Them
what a lot of young boys do, like
Calvin Miller
in that day, and come through the youth and actually play for the first team. But See, forget it. The young boy wants to go and move to Chelsea's, Man City's, Man United, PSG's, whoever they want to move to. See if he wants to move. See, as long as we get the compensation that we need for nurturing this boy, I'm quite happy. But see if he wants to stay and actually prove himself.
We talk about Dembele or
Dembele.
Young McCarthy.
Young Dembele.
Calvin Miller.
Oh, fucking young McCarthy.
No, he's no, 25 now. You can't, like, go dishing out, like, I hope he does well for himself. Because see if he leaves us for a fucking... And he's already halfway there. Because he said he's getting capped for England. He's no staying there, man.
As long as I'm saying, as long as we get the compensation,
we're going to get. Nah, get it right off him. Hope he's shite. I hope that young Dembele is shite. There you go. But I hope that young Calvin Miller isn't he shite.
But I was going to ask Chris, what did you make of Calvin Miller when he played, Chris?
I thought when Calvin Miller came on, I thought he was brilliant. And, I mean, it's like I was saying on the last Smell the Love we did, that, you know, anytime you get some kids that have grown up through the academy out there starting with the first 11, I mean, that's a dream come true, and that's so good to see that there's so much good development and talent coming through the academy. And, you know, just everybody that's come through there in the last little bit, I mean, they've all played together for as long as they have. And any time that a new guy, you know, comes in like Calvin Miller, I mean, it's just so good to see. I mean, I was thrilled for him.
Yeah, I thought he played really well. But we've got a lot of youngsters there. I mean, there's Ralston, and who's the striker? PJ Crossan that we got from, was it St Mirren?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He's still out there, too.
So there's a few there that you would expect to maybe get, you know, games at some point.
Don't forget, you still have Nesbitt out on loan, too.
Fucking Nesbitt, I forgot about him.
Yeah, he's over at Morton.
Yeah, he's brilliant.
Yeah, they've got a lot of kids in that team. A lot of kids in that team. So here's a question: Do you think Dembele gets a game with the senior team before he's 16 years old?
Maybe.
Remember, Aitchison played at 16 last year.
But he's what, 13 now?
He's, I mean, so that's 13, what, 14, three? Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, you still got a couple years. I don't know. I think you just wait and see. I mean,
who's the youngest ever Celtic player to start in the first team? Ooh. Does anybody know?
I have not a clue.
Not a clue. That's a great question.
That'd be something you have to Google.
Or as they said, giggle it.
Yeah. I don't know. But it is interesting. He, when you see him play, he's got the physicality. Like, the way he turns and stuff and the way he moves is beyond his years. And you can see that if anybody was going to get dropped in ahead of his age range, it would be someone like him. He's the kind of player that a coach or anyone who was training him would say, look, he could probably play a couple of years above him, you know, because of his talent and his ability to move and stuff. So who knows?
So here's the first thing I found. The youngest goal scorer is Aitchison.
Right, yeah.
16 years, 71 days. 16 years old, 71 days. What were you guys doing at 16 years old? I mean, what are you guys doing at 36 years old? Come on, really? 16 years old.
Yeah, but I'm not 36.
No. That's true.
Oh, just your beard. That's 36.
That's right.
So, I think he puts him in the first team and gets him at least a game like he did for Aitchison at the end of the season, like either this year or next year. I mean, doesn't that guarantee that they get money? Like once he's played for the first team, doesn't that guarantee you know, his transfer money for development, unlike what happened with Islam.
I don't know how it works. Don't know. Let's ask the Castle Milk boys if they're still there.
What are you saying? Sorry.
Yeah. Well, they're still there. I thought you'd passed out or something.
We're just having a wee conversation between ourselves.
Yes. I think I got leveled in the conversation. Apparently, boy just got hooked right in their face. What are you saying, up there?
Right, so bring us back up to the date with the conversation. Sorry, man.
They were just talking about Karamoko Dembele, and who was the youngest, can you remember the youngest player ever to play for the first team, like, in the history of the club?
There's no young McGeady.
No. Tierney, man, it's probably...
Tierney?
I've
been Tierney, actually, yeah.
I seen Tierney playing for us, I genuinely felt a pure...
No, you're talking about the youngest player or the youngest
Hitchison, talent? Hitchison scored the goal. Youngest ever goal scorer.
Yeah, we saw that. But it was just who's the youngest player to make an appearance in the first
time?
You're
talking about the youngest talent we've seen.
Yeah.
So what one is it? The youngest talent or the youngest player?
Just the youngest player ever to actually come out and play for the first team, like, it's youngest
probably
age.
The youngest player I've seen. But the youngest talent I've seen is Kieran Tierney. The youngest actual potential talent I've seen at Parkhead is quite big here in Tierney.
Because how old was Sean Maloney when he played? He was quite young as well, was he not?
Isn't he that young?
Was he not?
No, I remember when Maloney played personally, man.
Was that when the Larson, Bravchik, Thompson, Hudson, and Sutton?
He played well before they got into the role, man. He was a player. See, when he came on as a player against the role, there's a young up and comer that I've never heard of to take a free kick.
You've got a guy like Maloney that had a player, a Leonafi, like Lubomir Mravchik.
Bobo's right, man.
You've got a player like Maloney learning off of Mravchik, or you've got a player like Kieran Tierney learning off of Zagiri, what would you prefer? I'm putting that out there to Dr. J.
Yes.
And what would you prefer? Would you prefer a Kieran Tierney learning off of Zagiri at left back, or would you prefer an attacking
midfielder,
Mravchik?
Ideologically, Mark just gave you everything you could ever have dreamed of. Imagine, like, from my point of view, when I was watching Celtic for how many years?
I don't know how many years have you been watching Celtic.
A lot of years. So, you can't get that match, can you not? You can't get that. You can't get that. Is what you want is a guy who's fucking taking a free kick, am I right?
Right. Back to Dr. J.
I can't even breathe.
Lead us into the outro song.
Lead us into the outro song.
I can see the train. The train's pulling out of the station.
The train is pulling from the station.
I think we've reached Bridgeton.
We've reached Bridgeton. We're about how many stops until we get to till we get to Gourock, so the end of the train, the end of the line. Oh my gosh, this has been out of control. They have this. Yes, Lisa is correct. The Ballboys had descended into utter carnage. That is exactly correct. So
okay.
So you know who would I rather have someone learn from? I personally, if I were to bring someone in, Lubo would be great to bring in. You know who's free of contract right now to bring in as a coach? Henrik Larsson.
That's a wee bit of a giveaway, man. But I think you're running scared from what this actually is. You knew this was going to be a big fuck up.
No reason to run scared. I like how they get into the it's going to be a fuck up and they mute themselves. That was really good.
Well, let's go with it then. So, Don't be scared.
Right, so
Colonial.
Last question. Last question for the ball boys.
Right? Yes.
Boys.
First question from the ball
no,
boys.
No. Last.
First question. Last question.
Where's the doorman? Can someone get a bouncer?
First question from the ball boys.
Right. So, like the question I put out, right, so is, would you rather have a player learning off of Tierney learning off of Zagiri or Maloney learning off of Lubo Moravcik? What is your preference?
Lubo, all day long.
Lubo. Definitely Lubo.
Well, I...
Yeah. Well, right now, don't forget, Tierney has Izagiri and a little bit of... Colo Touré to help him out, so I like the position. I like the position that Tierney's in right now.
Has Danny McGrain left the club? Because I know he had that heart issue last year, but he was training left backs for Celtic, was he not?
No, last year.
I'm sure Danny McGrain's still at the club, isn't he?
100%. Is he?
So he'll be involved with Tierney, surely.
I think the whole Colo Touré getting brought into the fold was a lot to do with the defensive weaknesses we've had there past seasons. I think even though Colo Touré was brought in at the start of the year and he was played in a lot of games, I don't think there was real intent in actually playing him as a first team player. I think he was brought in more on the fact that trying to consolidate the back and given a lot of experience. The guy has had a lot of experience, Champions League finals, UEFA Cup finals, so I think he was more brought in for the experience. Yeah. Oh.
Yep. Definitely. Because he's not been playing a lot of games, but he'll be involved. He's got heaps of experience.
I don't think we're going to see a lot from him, even in the future. But I think seeing the back room, you're not going to see a lot of that. But I think he's going to put a lot into the team as a whole. Mm-hmm.
It's good to have him in the club. I mean, you can't. He's from you know, and even when I was watching him on Celtic TV, and he comes across well. He seems like a decent guy, so it'll be good for the youngsters.
Did someone swallow a bear or something? What was that?
Was it?
Somebody land the plane.
Pull up, Cougar.
Pull up, Cougar.
Exactly. Well, boys, we've been 2 hours and 10 minutes of excitement.
Yep. I'm on. A single malt is nearly halfway down, but...
Oof. I will.
How many single malts?
I've had about five.
Colonial, I'm your dad podcast.
Baby Colonial, is it old Colonial or old Colonial?
You wish, my man. Hi, I'm your Colonial Dad podcast. Welcome to Colonial. I'm a wee bit of a dad.
Mark, I understand now. I understand, Mark, what you've got to go through.
Thanks very much.
I'm with you, mate. I'm with you.
So Chris, the way this works is, so right, the ball ends up being Cougar, and Mark is now Maverick.
What?
So Mark has become Maverick, and ball is now Cougar, like from Top Gun. So Mark's job is to help Cougar find the end of the aircraft carrier, so he can gently guide him in and help him land the plane. Because apparently Ball right now is on autopilot.
He's not even on autopilot, it's like wild pilot.
Oh god, this has been the best.
So how long have we been gone for? That's the, was that 2 hours?
Wait there, wait. Joe Coaster. Hey man.
You know, I'm disappointed. I tried to get Harper to come join us, but he was busy, and it would have been pretty funny to get a little mini rap battle too, impromptu.
Scared. He's scared.
It would have been interesting
for the rematch.
He's scared. He is scared.
He'll take anybody on in a rap battle. Anybody.
Half the world away.
Middle of the glove, Colonial, Belfast Boys, anyone we will take on in a rap battle.
Boys, don't get them.
They're too old. They can't have rap. They were back in the 90s. They don't even know what dabbing is. They don't even know what a dab is.
This is the guys who think that 50 Cent is a quality rapper, as Paul Larkin said.
Don't hit me with 50 Cent.
Wait. Who's 50 Cent?
Half a dollar.
Who's 50 Cent?
Half a dollar?
That's what they say, but I'm trying to snag this, but they said 50 Cent. Who was that? That's him who changed herself. They fucking fingers.
Okay. On that bombshell.
It's been a pleasure.
On that bombshell.
Let's do this again next year, shall we?
Yeah, so let's plan for this next year. Yes.
We should. We need to all do it in the same room.
End of season extravaganza, 6 in a row, going for 10.
Oh.
We'll do the Christmas special live. From Castle Milk.
From Castle Milk. Live from Castle Milk. I think that's the name of our next podcast. We smell the glove live from Castle Milk.
Be back on your support for our big Christmas celebration show next week, lads.
Yes.
We do this again. I don't know. Can we do this again? Can you get a liver transplant by then, Ba?
Chances are I'm already dead.
I don't know if your liver is going to be okay to travel after this. This is not good.
He's got a freezer full of them ready.
Well, Chris.
All right, boys.
Hail, hail. Good talking to you. Thanks for coming. Oh, Johnny's back. Johnny?
Johnny's still here. I forgot about Johnny.
No, I got fucking... my phone had a bit of a spasm. It sort of came up with some video on about Lee Griffiths, and then I couldn't get back in, and it froze off the internet, but I've been back in for a wee bit now, like. I was listening to 49p, listening to his album, and then Uncool in the Squad, there's got to be more, come on, Nas. Nas.
That could be a good name for their rap band, Uncool in the Squad.
Colonial.
I'm going to get you a t-shirt that just says Colonial on it, because that's all you ever say.
Right, hi. So, Faye, outside Castle Milk, the place that quality football players come from.
That ball was born. Look at from a distance, from his microscope.
you may
hail, Colonial. A hail fail from us, and a hail fail from the Colonial.
Oh, I love you,
man. Oh my God. You know what the best part about this podcast is?
I'll see you next year.
Yeah, tomorrow someone's going to listen to this and go, what the fuck happened? And I'm not talking to anyone listening now. I'm talking to someone talking now and coming back to listen to it. Getting right, actually just.
I blame you, because you were supposed to guide this
right into the side of a mountain. That's exactly what I did.
Sack the board.
Sack the board.
All right, boys.
Everybody, hail.
Hail, everybody.
Cocktails, I'll see you soon.
Hail, lads, sack the board.
Have a Merry Christmas.
Yes, Merry Christmas. And by the way, if you've made it through the 2 hours and 15 minutes of this, honestly, like, for just listening to this is crazy. We really, really do appreciate all of a sudden. I know if Bali would say it, if Mark agrees, I'm sure. Ewan, Brian, Chris, all of us, even Pat and down under, you know, we really do appreciate you guys listening and taking the time out of your day to check this out, because this is this is just stuff that we do because, I don't know, because just because we love it and we're glad you guys do it with us. So, hello, everybody. And I think instead of playing the Joey Garner song, we'll play something a little bit different. So, hello, everybody. Take care. And we'll talk to you soon. Chucky Arlaw.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, everybody. Take care.
Happy New Year.
Fuck Asimov.